Divine Truth Assistance Group. These group assistance sessions are about putting principles of divine truth into action. This discussion is part of the 2014 Australia Group 2 series, Jesus Gives Group Truth on the subject of sincerity and resistance, filmed on the 2nd of August 2014 in Monkerai, New South Wales, Australia.
Okay, well, we're going to dispense with the entire program today, except for a little bit in the afternoon where we'll be doing some homework. And there's some pretty good reasons why we want to do that. While you were watching the movie last night, myself, Corny, Liz and Mary had a meeting together, and we just wanted to discuss what we could do about the fact that this group over 4 days has barely changed since the first day, and what we could do about that in terms of what's happening with the group. So what we've done is we've decided on a few things, and we want to discuss those things with you. Sound all right? Now, remember on the very first day, I said that if you can't learn to love while you're here, it's going to be next to nigh impossible for you to learn to love anywhere else. And the reality is that while during our discussion last night, we decided to list all of the people in this audience who we felt were actually sincere about addressing their true condition and wanting to progress towards God. And you know how many people we came up with? 18. Now, there's 78 of you in the audience. So that means less than 25% of you don't have even a feeling of sincerity. So how do you feel about that? We cannot feel a feeling of sincerity from 75% of you. Now, because of that, we have found it very difficult to engage you the entire week. There's a lot of resistance in this group. And because of that also, there are a lot of spirits influencing this group constantly. The majority of you are in heavy addictions every single interaction. If you could have seen last night at the kitchen, at dinner, and really see what was really going on, you would have noticed huge amounts of addictive interactions going on constantly. Most of you were in addiction last night in your interactions. Now, even though most of you are in addiction, about 18 of you are sincere about it, at least. But the rest of you are not even sincere about it. You're not even sincerely looking at what's really going on in your day-to-day life. So, myself, Mary and Cornelius do not want to have another 3 days where we talk to 75% of the group who is insincere. We're not going to do that. So something's going to have to change today. That makes sense? So what I'd like to do first is give you a bit of an illustration, just to help you conceive what's going on for yourself. The illustration, let's make this whole board here a map. And here, there is a compass that you're given. And on the northern end of this compass, what we might say the upper end of the compass, that's the direction of love. So instead of it being north, it's the direction of love. And opposite to that is obviously the direction of fear. And of course, anything that's opposing love, which actually degrades into being quite evil at times, right? And then you could say the other directions, the westerly and easterly directions, are all just distractions to north, love, all right? And here's our map. Now, at the bottom of our map, there's this great big valley. And I'd call that the valley of death. Now, on the side of the valley of death, or just above the valley of death, there's, on one side, there's all these small foothills. And I'm going to call those the foothills of personal truth. And on the other side of the valley, which probably should be in black, there's this great big foggy area, which is the fogs of doubt, fear and indecision. Now, above those areas, there's this really bleak area. Above both of those areas, this is quite large. Should we call that the deserts, the desert of pain and suffering? Start to get the picture of what this map's all about. Above the deserts of pain and suffering, there's these wonderful mountains. Big mountains that you're going to have to navigate at some point in your life. Right? And that's the mountains. Mountains of truth. This one's God's truth, right? Above the mountains of God's truth, there's this area on the side. Really quite nice area. Should we call it? We call it, it's just a big area, big plain, and there's this sort of like a staircase going up to it of waterfalls and had stairs all through this beautiful winding valley. We could say that is the staircase of, or the, you could say it's the, is that staircase, is that the way we wanted to use the word? Probably. It's the steps to natural beauty. And this, you could say, is just natural beauty. Beautiful area up there. On this side, though, there's a place that's even more beautiful, and I just wish I had another colour, but this is the place of, and it just goes up, and it's celestial beauty. And there's another staircase, some of which comes from the staircase of natural beauty, right? But some also come from way down here, all the way up. So if we go staircase, and then you could say that's the celestial staircase. Baby?
It's just one more region on your map that I'd like to add. Is that all right?
What's that? Yeah.
Right down there, just above the Valley of Death.
Yeah.
Is the La La Land of Facade and Denial.
Ah, yes, we've forgotten the La La Land of Facade. Yes. So we've got to put that in here. Just here that is. La La Land of Facade and addiction. Okay. So you're given the map. God gives you the map. God gives you the compass. The compass is, if you focus your direction in terms of love, you'll be able to navigate this map. But if you don't focus your direction in terms of love, all sorts of things will happen to you. Right? And then God sends you 14 other souls back, who's already been there, to tell you how to even get there and show you. Actually, they're trying to show you through what they do. Just show you how to get there. And you know what most of you do? You look at the map, and then you've got the compass, and then you go, what's the first question you probably have to ask yourself? If you've got a map and you've got a compass, what's the first question you need to ask yourself? Tess, at the back. Just say, if you say it in the mic.
Where am I?
Where am I? Important piece of information, isn't it? Like, if you are here facing that direction, right, and you think you are here facing that direction, this is a problem, right? You've got to know where you are. You've got to discover where you are. And there's all these tools to help you discover where you are. And you know what most of you are doing? Completely ignoring them. All these tools to show you where you actually are. And then, of course, there's a second part of the information. Once you know where you are, what would be the next logical thing to try to decide? Saint Angela.
Where do I need to go?
Not where do you need to go, because remember...
Where do I want to go?
Where do you want to go? Yes, where do you want to go? Okay. So it's not about what you need to do. Nobody's telling you what to do here. You don't have to go anywhere. You can explore anywhere in this wonderful landscape, the universal, you could call it your universal landscape. You can explore anywhere in it. So it's all to do with where you want to go. So those two questions. Where are you right now? Where do you want to go? Are the two most important questions that you really need to ask. After getting the map and getting the compass, you'll be able to make some decisions and choices as long as you know where you are now and where you want to go. All right. So how does that illustration strike you? Now, if I believe that I'm in a place completely different to where I am actually, and the people who are around me who've already done it once before are telling you, actually, you're in a place completely different than what you believe, and you still believe that you're right, what would you call that? Thanks.
Arrogance.
Yeah, you'd call that arrogance, wouldn't you? But isn't it also self-defeating arrogance, isn't it? It's self-defeating. And this is where many of you are actually, in that place, where you're being self-defeatist with regard to holding on to your personal opinions about where you are. Okay. Now, because of that, you also receive a whole heap of other influences. Once you start believing you're right and start believing that where you are is not really where you are, now you're open to all sorts of other people making suggestions to you who also have no idea where they are. But they, just like you, believe they know where they are. So that's a bit of an issue, isn't it? As soon as you become open to those kind of suggestions, it's like somebody who's down in this land here, the la-la land of facade and addiction, they're going, I'm not there. I'm way up here. I'm already very developed. You know, I know everything that's being said to me. I understand it all. You know, I'm not there. I'm way up here. And I'm telling you, you're actually here when you're actually up here. And if you listen to them, that's not going to get you very far either, is it? So at some point, you're going to have to work out how to analyze where you actually are right now. And in some cases, some of you are in a place that's better than the person you're listening to. And if you follow their directions, you'll go in completely the opposite direction that you need to go. That's happening in some cases. Okay. Now, how does that relate to what I just raised opening with you? And that is that we feel that 75% of you are not sincere. How does that relate to you feel? Thanks, Bruce.
75% of us don't know where we are.
You don't know where you are, that's one thing. So, and it's okay, in a way, isn't it, to not know where you are initially, but there's a bigger problem. What's that? If we go to Rob, and then to Jennifer.
We don't want to know where we are.
You don't want to know where you are, and what else, Jennifer?
We're in the land of la-la, facade and addiction.
Well, that's what you assume, but you don't really know that either.
Okay.
Right? So, Jane, over here. Jane, keep your hand up because it's really hard if you don't. Yeah.
Jane, we're in denial.
You're in denial of what, though? What are you in denial of?
Denial of where we are and even denying our condition.
Right. Yeah, but there's a lot more that you're denying than just that. Go across to Anto.
Anto, how to change and how to...
I agree, but there's a lot more that you're denying than even that. If we go across to Linda.
Linda, we're denying God's laws and the truth that we've already learnt.
True, but let's look more personal. What else are we doing?
Just don't want to do it.
We're denying that we don't even want to. Yeah. No, that's what we're denying. Most of us are denying that we don't even want to, that we feel actually very resistive to. We feel we have to, we feel we should, but we don't really want to. So we're denying the thing that we talked about on the first day. We deny that we're even, like we're here, but are we really here? Is the majority of us really here? You haven't even, many of you have not even participated yet. We're in the sixth day. And many of you haven't even participated. And in fact, I can say all of the women that have ever participated, you've all participated in facade and addiction. Every single interaction I have had with a woman in this entire, program that we've put together, every single personal interaction I've had, every single interaction I've had with you as a group has been with you in an addiction. Every single one. There hasn't been one sincere woman-based interaction that I've had in this entire program. Now, there has been a few men personal interactions that have been sincere, but none from the women at all. This is a big problem, right? How can we expect to progress if we are in that place where we're completely being insincere, even in the interactions where we think that we're being sincere? Yeah, it's a big problem. So what can we do about it? So myself and Corny and Mary were talking about last night. What can we do to help you see what's really going on here? And we are tired now, very tired, of having all of these spirit influences that's around you still here after 6 days or 5 days have gone past, and it's still here. It's still damaging the people who are open to it, but many of you like it, and you want this spirit influence. It's oppressive, extremely oppressive, what's going on in this group. Now, in the last group, we had 75% of the people, or perhaps a bit less than that, about 70% of the people actually being sincere. Now, they might have gone away and become insincere, I don't know, right? I haven't caught up with them since. But while they were here, they were being sincere. In this group, we've got the opposite issue. We've got 70-75% being insincere on purpose with no desire to even know that they are and no desire to shift forward. Now, if you were the person speaking to a group like that, what would you do? What would you do? You see, you'd have to do something, wouldn't you? Because it's a waste of your time and effort to continue doing what you're currently doing. Right? And we're saying that everyone bar those 18 people who are sincere is wasting our time and effort. And you don't care. You don't care because you want something else from this program other than truth and other than to sincerely change and become more loving people. You want something else. So what are we going to do about it? That's the question. So we're just sitting there, three of us, working, mulling over what we can do about it. Well, firstly, we know that we don't want to repeat the same effort that we've put into it over the last 4 days for the next 3 days without there being any change. So we know we don't want to do the same as what we've done, number one. Number two, we know that we're going to have to somehow demonstrate to you that we're serious about you wasting our time, because many of you think it's okay to waste our time all the time. So that's number two. Number three, we have to get some kind of, during this process, some kind of education in love also needs to occur. And it would be great if the only thing you learnt from this whole thing was that how resistive you are. But there needs to be some acknowledgement, some kind of awareness of that going on inside of yourself, right? Number three, so how do we do that? How do we create some awareness of what's really going on? So what we've decided to do is this. We're going to give you an opportunity each day. The opportunity will happen for the entire four-hour session each day. This is the opportunity. And by the way, if you don't take the opportunity today, you will have no opportunity tomorrow. We will just ask you to not come tomorrow or the next day. So you must engage this opportunity each day if you want to remain. This is the opportunity that we would like to see you engage. And we're not telling you have to, but we're telling you at the end of this day, if you have not engaged this opportunity, we do not want to see you tomorrow. And if we end up with 18 people, we'd be perfectly happy to have a lovely chat with 18 people about their relationship with God. We think that would be very positive. But we hope we end up with a few more than that. But that's up to you. Okay, so this is what we're going to do. Every time today that you put up your hand and you're insincere, one of us is going to shake our head like this and just say you're being insincere. If you refuse to put up your hand at all, you will not come tomorrow or the next day. You will not. If you refuse to engage at all because you're afraid of having this happen, you will not come tomorrow. Does that make sense? We would like to see every single person today engage the program. Now, that doesn't mean that we will necessarily get to ask you something. But we'd like to see every single one of you engaging it in a sincere manner. And if you do not engage it in a sincere manner, you will not be coming tomorrow or the next day to the program. You can stay here, whatever you want. You can still eat the food, whatever. But you will not be coming to the program. Because we do not want to use all this energy on people who do not or are not being sincere with us. You see, you've thought in your day-to-day life, many of you, you've thought that when you're insincere, that's when you get rewarded. Well, actually, here it's going to be completely the opposite. When you're insincere, you're not going to get rewarded at all. You're going to get corrected. Does that make sense? Yeah. So this is what we've decided to do. If you're insincere with regard to your comments, we will go like this at you. So think again, have another thought. Go, okay, they're saying I'm insincere. And some of you will be dumbfounded. You will be, because the majority of you are dumbfounded when it comes to knowing where you are in this map. You've got no idea. Right? And you'll be dumbfounded when we go, that wasn't sincere. And you go, I thought I was being sincere. No, not sincere. try again. Try to participate again. Now, any of you who get angry through this process with us today, you will leave immediately, actually. Okay? You will leave immediately. You're okay. It's okay if you feel angry. I got no problem with that. But if you project anger at rage at three people who are trying to assist you, you will leave. All we're doing here is trying to assist you. We're giving you our time, trying to assist you to make some breakthroughs in your personal progress. But you've got to get out of this self-deluded state that the majority of you are in. Okay? Now, many of you have been in this state for the whole time we've known you. 5 years, 6 years, some of you we've known you. You've been in this deluded state. We've not seen any change in that time inside of you to will to love. Others of you who are sincere, we have seen a change in your will to love. But as I said, there's very little people at the moment who are here who have a will to love. You have a very strong developed will to maintain your facade and live in addiction for the rest of your life. And that's a problem. Okay. So, is there anything else that we were going to do that you can remember? No, that was probably... if you just switch on, yeah.
We were just going to mention to people that using fear and panic as a projection towards us is also an addiction. And
we'll address that as well, as in sincerity. Yeah. So in other words, if you put up your hand and go, I'm really, really afraid, you're going to have to put your hand down again because you're going to get this. Because the majority of you aren't really, really afraid, you know. The majority of you are really, really angry. Not afraid, you're angry. So be honest about where you're at. This is why you have so many angry spirits with you. This is why it's so oppressive being with you, because you're so angry and you're not even acknowledging it. When you acknowledge it, some of this angry spirits will go away, but you're not acknowledging it, how angry you feel about progression, about God, about God's laws, all these things you're angry about. We'll talk to you about a bit about some of it.
Just, and also that often throughout the week we've received the comment of people that they're very afraid, when actually the feeling we feel is that they just don't wish to receive any truth.
Yeah.
And that would be more sincere to say, I just don't want to hear any truth or confront where I am on the map.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So to be honest with you, you would be more sincere saying, I don't want to hear any truth from you, just feed my addiction, than you have been like the last week. Many of you would be more sincere to say, I just don't want to hear any truth. And some of you would even be sincere saying, I've got no idea why I'm here. I came here expecting you to do a whole heap of things for me, actually. Because that's what many of you came for. You came here expecting myself, Mary and Cornelius, to do all these things for you. And we're not. We can't. It's your life. We can't live your life. We can't live with you 24/7, helping you live your life in harmony with love. We can't do that. But you expect us to. You expect to come along to seminars to be cheered up and you know, create some hope in you about your own personal progress. Like, we've said everything we can say about the hope for years. Like, the reality is there's now over 1,300 hours of education about love on video. That's video alone. That's without the books and all the other things that are being created. That's a lot of hours of education of love. If you don't know where you're going by this stage after watching that for 3, 4, 5 years, then I'm telling you, you're in huge amounts of addiction and facade. You've got no idea where you're at. And this is something you've got to come to terms with if you're ever going to change. And it's no good you keeping on coming along to seminars that Jesus and Mary and Cornelius provide to you, hoping that something will change, because nothing will change until you change it. We can't change your life for you. God won't, I won't, and anybody who loves you won't change your life for you, because they all will recognize that actually it's loving for them to accept that this is why you want your life to be. And most of you want your life to be in complete facade and addiction. Most of you do not want to feel your pain and suffering. Most of you are completely avoiding truth. And which direction do you think you're headed? Like most of you think you're headed towards the celestial heavens. And you're not. You're headed in completely opposite direction and have been ever since we've known you. And in fact, it's gotten worse for many of you over the time we've known you because your arrogance about your intellectual knowledge has built to this high level when you have no emotional awareness whatsoever. And so your whole situation has actually worsened since we've known you as a result of this building arrogant feeling inside of you that you know everything, all the truth that there is to know. Most of you have no awareness in your soul whatsoever of anything that we've talked about. Most of you have no awareness of humility at all, no awareness of God's truth at all. Soul-based awareness I'm talking about. You've got all this intellectual knowledge, but no soul-based awareness. So we are going to ask those people who are resistive to by the end of the day, and what we're going to do is we're going to, before you leave today, we're going to ask you to file out one by one. It's a shame it's gotten to this, because you've all had an opportunity. We're going to ask, and those 18 people who have already been engaging and actually with sincerity, you're already through to the next day. But the problem is that most of you don't even know who you are. So you don't even know when you're being sincere compared to when you're not being sincere. So that's going to be interesting by the end of the day, don't you think? And what we're going to do is we're going to ask you to, as you go out to dinner, and hopefully we'll get to do it, then we'll give us enough time. We want to finish around 3:30 just to give us enough time. And we're going to ask you to file out, and then we say, yes, you're allowed to come tomorrow. And no, you're not allowed to come tomorrow or the next day. And you know what's so sad about this? The fact that you have to be told this is very, very sad. That's very sad. Now, many of you who are feeling bad at the moment have actually already been engaging. So this is a problem too. You're not really understanding where you're at. And many of you who are feeling okay at the moment actually haven't been engaging. So this is where you're going to have to be a lot more self-analytical today about what's really going on. Are you being sincere? Now, we're going to do this from now on in our groups. And the reason why we're going to do this is because we feel a lot of people have been just using these groups as a way to cheer themselves up to get onto their next bit of life in their addiction and facade, instead of thinking that we're serious about helping people grow towards God. And you're allowed to choose to do whatever you want. We honour that. But when you come along to want something that we're presenting, now our rules apply. Yep. And isn't that fair enough? We're giving our time, our rules apply. We've arranged it, our rules apply. If you don't like our rules, right, which we feel are all based around love, if you don't like them, then go and make your own rules and base them around what you think love is. And you do some seminars and teach old people about, give them an education in what you believe love to be and see how that works out. We're happy for you to do that. You just can't stay here thinking that everything's fine when it's not. Does that sound all right? Lani, what would you like to ask?
I'd just like to say that I've been projecting anger and and I've been deceiving myself that it's been fear instead.
Lani, you have no idea. You have no idea how you feel, do you? No. And this is a problem because you get easily led by others. You are one of the persons who we feel is sincere. Right? However, you have no idea. And this is what makes you very open and susceptible to spirit and negative person on earth influencing you into a state where you've got no idea what you're doing. And this is a problem. Like, you need to be able to get this compass and the map and work out where you are.
It's true. I've no idea.
You've got no idea, and this is the problem, right? So honour the fact you've got no idea. You want some people to help you find out where you are, right? So you need to honour that feeling that you have. But often there's a number of you in the audience who believe you're a lot worse than you are, and this is a problem because that keeps you completely open to attack by the other people who are here. You get attacked and manipulated, told that you need to do things that you don't need to do anymore. All those things happen for some of you who are sincere. Some of you who are sincere get hammered by these people who are not sincere, and you actually believe they know what they're talking about when they have no idea themselves what they're talking about. And that is a problem. Yeah.
But I've felt really like a fear barrier to... Like I've really wanted to come and, you know, be able to engage you and Mary and Corny, and I've felt like I can't.
However, even though you've felt a fear barrier about personal engagement, though, you have engaged this process in the auditorium. You have. You've been enthusiastic to know where you're at, and you've been self-analytical, so this is a good thing, right? Now, yes, I do know that you haven't engaged us because of fear, but that's okay to me. Like, you've at least engaged some of this program. Like, we can't have 78 discussions of 1 hour long with every single person here. We can't, because that's 78 hours, and the whole waking hours of the entire week are less than that, if in terms of what's available, so it's impossible for us to do that. But you all have the same opportunity to engage here. 4 hours every day. Every day you've had 4 to 5 hours of possibility of engagement. Right? So that's 4 or 5 hours already times 4 days. There's 16 to 20 hours already that you could have engaged that many of you have not. Or if you have, you've engaged it in complete insincerity, many of you. You've not been sincere in any single comment aside from a comment of what, you know, when we're asking you a fact and you tell us a fact. But when it comes to your personal feelings and emotions, most of you tell us something that's completely insincere. And I'm just going, oh no, here we go again. Ivana, next. And across.
Up until Justin did the question with you the other day,
yep.
I've found myself being quite resistive.
Very resistive, yep.
Yeah.
I agree.
And but then I felt a change after that. Does that just mean an addiction of mine got met?
Yes. You like to hear that the man's doing something wrong, and that's the reason why your relationship isn't working with him.
Yep.
Right? You don't want to see that there's also you doing things wrong. So when he gets told he's doing something wrong, you go, yes, yes, at last some truth here, which is true, but that's the only reason why you feel relieved.
Okay.
It's not because you've actually faced some truth. You've just faced some truth that he's actually doing some things still out of harmony with love. That's all you've done here.
Yep.
And a lot of you do this. A lot of you do this. You're so overjoyed when I discuss truth with someone else other than you. But when I discuss truth with you, what do you feel then? Completely the opposite, usually. Resistive, angry, bitter, twisted.
Yeah.
So you got to watch that. That's an addiction.
Yep.
That's you enjoying somebody else's having to confront truth, while at the same time completely resisting your own. You have no desire personally to confront your own truth.
Yep.
Yeah. Does that make sense?
Yep. Yep.
My name's Alan. Jesus, I've got a huge resistance to education. It only really became to my awareness this morning.
Yep.
And I've got very little education in my life. However, I've always been able to get through.
Yep.
And I've never wanted to do any courses at all. I've tried to avoid all courses at all cost.
Yep.
I'm petrified to be here.
Yep.
And I was too scared to come. All kinds of things going on. Even at school, it was fair tactics to try and educate us.
Yes.
But I feel that it came well before then as well.
I agree, because it always gets settled in your childhood, right? Yep.
Yeah, I just wanted to share that. I only just realised it this morning. However, yep. I think it's...
So can I just point out, resistance to education is anger about education.
Definitely, and I only just realised that while you were talking this morning. I felt quite angry. I never felt it before.
Yep.
To the point that it surfaced this morning.
All right. So when you go, I'm angry about education, what's the only thing that's going to change your anger about education? If you think about what you've been taught up to now.
Engage.
Will you engage the education, which would be the opposite of what the addiction demands. The addiction demands that you ignore education. You engage education, you feel your anger, but what's the anger covering?
The emotion.
Emotion of what? There's obviously emotions of sadness and like violence and all sorts of things that have happened during many of our educations, right?
Yeah.
And grief. And you're denying those emotions.
Yeah.
So you need to get to them. Because honestly, how are you ever going to grow in love if you refuse all education in love and you're just angry about education generally?
Well, I feel that it blocks me in all sorts of areas because for me to absorb or even remember simple things, even shortly after being taught, I've been in a classroom where I've had to stand up and repeat something that was just said and I can't do it.
Yep.
I've been so resistive that absorbing is terrible, absolutely good. Shocking.
So, Alan, that's a great awareness of something that's come as to why there's a resistance. But now you've got some emotional work to do if you ever want to change that. Honestly, if you stay resistive to education the rest of your life, you're going to stay resistive to education about love, and that's going to be very detrimental to your life.
Yep. Yeah, I feel that.
Yeah, yep. Okay, if we go up to the back. Right up the back. And is that Andrew? Grant, yes, Grant.
Yeah, I'm Grant. If I'm not engaging, I'm totally clueless. I feel as if I am.
No, you're not.
Okay.
This is the first time, isn't it? Or you've only had one or two interactions with somebody up until this point? Is this the first time you've publicly said anything?
Today, this week, yes.
Yeah, so I'd say that's not engaging, right?
Okay.
Yeah.
I sort of feel
what, like... What happened the first day? You got cold overnight. What happened?
What happened? I had a big headache.
Yep.
I didn't sleep. I got a big headache that day.
You had no sleep, right?
No.
No?
So towards the end of the day, I got a little angry when you talked about the books.
Yep.
Because I felt like later on I sort of could see your point about that.
Yep. But remember, that was the first group truth on the first day, and a lot of you got angry about it. A lot of you also went into addiction and facade about it, right? So this is... One little truth, one tiny little truth. Yeah, keep going.
Okay, and then, I had a nauseous headache and I decided to bail.
Yep. So that's you bailing out of a situation you attracted, bailing out of a situation you attracted in order to avoid a whole heap of emotion inside of yourself. Is that sincere? Is it sincere to do that? I don't do that.
Well, I have issues with being sincere in that situation when I was sort of in a very desperate sort of place.
No, desperation, remember, is addiction. Remember, we learnt that 2 days ago. Every time you feel desperate, like you've just got to go something, you've got to get out of the situation, you've got to run, you've got to whatever, that's an addiction. This is an addiction you've lived in for much of your life. Every time things get tough...
Okay.
What do you do?
Yeah, I can see. I sort of had a think about it overnight and discovered that this was about my law of attraction with me not being worthy.
It's partly that.
Yeah.
Partly that. But every time you're confronted, see, this is where a lot of you are not being sincere. You go, oh, yes, I have feelings of unworthiness, or I had fear, or I had whatever it is, but actually you're not really feeling the real feeling at the top of all of that. This is a lot of times what you guys are doing are you're selecting what you think the emotion is, because that emotion that you think is more preferable to the emotion that's actually going on. Does that make sense? And that's insincerity. If you were really sincere, you would feel the emotion actually going on. Does that make sense?
Okay. I understand. Well, I don't really understand, but
that's okay. Okay. But I can see you came here, and to be honest with you, you got absolutely hammered by some women spirits because of the women who brought these spirits along here, and you got absolutely hammered the first day. Like, you're totally open to it, totally open to it. And if you think about it, you've been hammered by women a lot of your life, right?
Exactly.
Haven't you? Yes, but you don't want to feel about it. You see, this is the problem. That's where the insincerity is. You don't want to feel about it. You just want to get out of the situation.
I feel like I've been working on it. I'm letting little bits out of the balloon.
I haven't seen that this week, Grant. What I've seen is you running away from situations where you could actually engage and actually stand up for truth and love. You run away from those situations when you're getting hammered. And in fact, most of the time, you don't even realize that's the reason why you feel like running away, because you're getting hammered. Many of you men are feeling the same as this.
Okay. Thank you. I appreciate that.
Yep. If we go next to you.
I'm feeling now that I'd really
If you just say your name.
Oh, sorry. Pamela.
Pamela, has everyone met Pamela? Not yet.
I'm feeling now that I'd really like your input, but can you feel that I'm insincere in this? Or
there's two women who are the most insincere women in this entire place, and you're one of them.
Yes. Well, do I stop now?
Why are you so insincere, Pamela?
Well, yesterday I thought, this is great. I've got all the tools. Now I'm going to go and sort of do this.
Yeah, can I just say...
Stop
for a moment. You had an interaction with Mary yesterday where you went to Mary and said, what was the actual conversation? Was it Mary? Was it Rose? It was Rose. Oh, okay. So it wasn't you, it was Rose. Where's Rose? Yep. You had an interaction. We want to talk about that in a minute. But go on.
So I thought I got to the fact that I need to feel my anger. And I did certain things.
Can I stop you again, Pamela? You're always feeling your anger.
Yeah.
You're constantly angry.
Yep.
How you treat everyone is all based on your expectations and demands.
Yes. Yes.
You don't need to feel your anger. You're already in it. You need to start feeling, why are you so angry?
Yes, yes. Well, I think...
No, see, you say yes, yes, you see. Yes, yes, without any emotional acknowledgement is just what happened in you. No, none at all. You're being completely insincere. You go yes, yes, and I'm hearing no, no from your soul. You didn't even hear what I said. What did I just say?
You said that I wasn't, the virtual fact that I was hearing you, but I'm not actually, that I've been angry all the time and I'm feeling my anger, but I'm denying that.
And what did I say you needed to do about it?
I'm being insincere about it, it.
No, I said what you need to do about it, which you just immediately skipped over. You didn't even want to hear it. I said, you've got to find out why.
Oh, why? Yep.
Why? You ignored that completely.
Well, because
can we stop? No, you're being insincere all the time. Let's move on. Any person who does this with me today, that's it. Miranda. No, wait for the mic, Miranda.
Miranda. I was really only today, or actually starting yesterday, last night, that looking at Mary's homework about why don't I want to engage, about challenging my addictions. And I found that it's like I had a hard time just like trying to, or feeling why do I want that? And I think today I'm starting to realize that I don't have a sincere desire to really challenge my addictions because...
Miranda, can I stop you? You're being insincere right now. You are so used to saying what a person what you think they need to hear, that you can't be honest with yourself. The reality is every single interaction I've seen you in this entire week so far has been full of demand and rage. Interactions with the venue and the venue staff, and also interactions with us, right? And you are not being honest about how angry you are. You're a very angry person, right? And you're not being honest about it. So stop telling yourself about fear or any other thing, or that, oh, it's all just addiction and whatever else. No, it's rage, which means that most of the time you don't get your addictions met, most of the time. And this is great. This is God treating you with love. God doesn't want you to have any of your addictions met, right? Because God's trying to show you that all of these addictions are out of harmony with love. But you're not seeing it as such. You engage the rage every time and go and do what the demand tells you to do every time. I haven't observed you do it differently the entire week. Right? So, again, very insincere analysis of yourself. Can we go across to Jennifer?
Thank you. Jennifer, I'm aware that I've got denial of anger, but I'm not feeling my anger.
There is just like a mountain of it coming out of you constantly. Okay. Like any person who's in your company can feel it. So I agree, you're not even aware of it, but you are feeling it because it comes out of you towards everyone. So you just don't want to be aware of it. Why?
Maybe because it's overwhelming?
No. Because if you have to acknowledge that you're angry, you automatically think that means that your condition is much, much worse. But actually, your condition would improve substantially if you could just acknowledge how angry you are. You have all this facade-based belief that as long as I go around making out I'm not angry to the rest of the world, then it means that I am actually in a better condition than what I imagine, than what I actually am. You want to maintain a facade about where you actually are. And that's what most of the women here want to do. They want to do exactly the same thing. They want to maintain a facade about how they actually are. We'll talk about this in a minute.
So I felt a bit of a twinge when you said no woman who's interacted with you the whole week has been sincere.
Yeah.
And I wondered whether I was one of them.
Of course you're one
of
them.
I'm definitely one of them.
Did you interact with me at any time during the week?
No.
No. Like you've had every interaction, you've answered questions in when I'm standing here.
Yes.
And I'm telling you in every one of those you were insincere.
Yeah, I kind of concluded that.
Yes. But you still didn't believe it was you, right?
No.
No.
No, I didn't.
Exactly. Can you see how blunt I can be?
Yeah.
And yet you still don't get what I'm saying. I said quite clearly, no interaction with any woman I've had this week has been based on sincerity on behalf of the woman. And you've had many interactions with me by just putting up your hand and answering questions and getting engaged.
None of them.
And none of them have been sincere.
I've always been in facade.
Always.
Yep. Okay.
Always. Not being honest. Look, I will help you in a minute get to see what's really in you as a group.
There's one thing. I had an interaction with Mary last night. Mm-hmm. At some stage I'd like to maybe even talk to Mary about it.
It was very much in facade, Jennifer.
Yes, I realised that later. And, yeah, I sort of did a bit of work on analysing that last night.
So. Yeah. You know what happens, like, how long did Mary say that she had to work on her facade before she got anywhere near her hurt self? Can you remember? Five, years. Mary has a discussion with one of you ladies. The next day you come to her and say, oh, yeah, I understand what you were meaning now. She's just told you it's taken her 5 years to work out what I was meaning, and you're telling her that it took you one night to sort out what she was meaning to you. You've got no idea. No idea. It's going to take you a lot longer than that of real sincere effort to actually work out what's being said to you. Yep.
Thank you.
Engage the sincere effort, but you need to be shown when you're not being sincere. Rose.
Rose.
By the way, you were one of those people who went to Mary and said, I worked it all out now.
I know. I want to talk to that if I can at the moment.
No.
That I agree I was in complete facade.
Yeah, I agree, but what do you want to, why did you put up your hand?
Because I am realizing I have lived in
Rose, stop. You put up your hand because you want Daddy, me, to recognize that you actually get something. That's why you put up your hand. You're in another addiction putting up your hand. Let's move on. Who else? Brave people now. Trent. Is this your first or second engagement, I think? Is it third, maybe, for the entire week?
Yeah, almost for 3 or 4 years, I think.
Yeah, I agree. Fire yes. away. Lovely shirt, by the way.
Thank you. Yeah, I really dislike public speaking.
Yep, it's a fear.
Yeah.
I'm yep. Very what nervous. Do you do with fears?
Deny it.
Well, that's what you do. But what did Mary suggest you do with challenging addictions?
Go beneath it to find what the fear is covering.
She did, but she said she told you how to do it.
Yeah.
She said, don't feed the addiction. Every time you remain silent, you're feeding your addiction.
Yes.
Every time. It's not going to benefit. You're just feeding the addiction. That's why you're... So there needs to be some shift of awareness inside of you going, I'm staying silent. I can feel this desperate urge to stay silent. You know, even when there's sometimes I want to get engaged, you put up your hand, you almost, I can't do that. I want to stay silent. There's the desperation in you to stay silent. Now, why are you so desperate about staying silent? It's a good question, isn't it?
Yes.
What do you feel when you're not silent?
At times I feel I'm not heard.
Yes.
When I speak.
So you're angry about not being heard.
Yes.
So being silent means you can live in this anger about not being heard.
Yeah.
What else?
Obviously staying with a facade, people don't get to see the real me.
They don't, yes. They have to work to get to see you, Trent.
Yes.
Like Trent isn't just himself, he's just making people around him work, so that's an anger thing.
I certainly sit on the fence a lot.
Yep, you don't have to come to decisions. You are allowed to have doubt and indecision all the time.
So that I can sort of please everyone rather than people find out more about myself as well?
Correct. So it's all about trying to please other people rather than actually engage a life that you might find you really love but other people attack.
Yes.
So it's actually about avoidance of a lot of attack.
Yeah. Of blockaded angry women for... All my life.
All your life, yeah. You were taught how to do it by your mother, right?
Yeah, son of wanting daughters.
Yep.
So
you get in a group of angry women like this is, and you're like, I'm staying quiet. No way, no, I'm saying, we keep putting myself out there.
But I feel that the last couple of days with demanding and angry women, of it's ramping up in this environment.
Yep.
And... At times I may not have been loving when I've expressed myself. I've sort of felt I'd like to stretch, and yet to say it hasn't necessarily been in a loving manner,
yep.
Which I've also taken note of.
So this, to me, this is our first sincere interaction. Fantastic. Our first sincere interaction between you and I.
That's right. I've talked to you a couple of times, but you've mentioned it previously, people... you know, you're down the supermarket, and you're like, oh, this person wants to talk to me, you feel something completely different. So we've had small interactions in the past, but
yeah,
an unworthiness or different emotions have come up that I've shown.
No, it's not the unworthiness, it's the justification of it. The thing that you're trying to make me work to find out what's in you.
Yes.
And you don't understand that I already can feel what's inside of you. There's that as well. You don't believe that's true. But you're trying to make me work for what's inside of you. And I'm going, I can't feed this addiction, Trent.
Yes.
I can't keep feeding it. This is where you've spent a lot of your life, having other people work for what's inside of you. And this is why not many people really know you. Like, if you wore your heart on your sleeve, as the saying goes, lots more people would know you and actually enjoy your company. But the fear and your willingness to pander to your fear by having an addiction of silence, right, causes you to not go any further with that. Mm. Yep.
Yeah.
Good, eh? Thank you. If we come down to Ella.
I was going to say quite a lot, but I think it's all down to the fact that I'm desperate for you to agree now with my negative self-analysis.
Well, can I just stop you? You are enraged. You are, of all the people in the audience here, you are one of the few women that are in the most rage. Right? And this rage has been going on for a long time. And you said an amazing thing a few days ago to Mary in one of her presentations. You actually said that people like you this way. Yeah, you did. Over there,
it
you were sitting.
It was in the presentation with Cornelius.
Was it with Cornelius?
You said, I don't want to change because people like me this way.
You said, I don't want to change because people like me better this way. No, you did. You were right there. I've got a recording of it. Now, yeah, that's right. You've got no idea what you say half the time. No idea at all. So that's a problem. That means you're getting influenced to say some of those things, and there's a belief in you that you are your best self now. And I can't agree. If you could feel the real self and compare that with what you currently are, you'd be, like, honestly, you'd want to be your real self. But you're going to have to go through some very hard emotions to get there, and you don't want to. You want to make other people responsible for everything to do with your own development. That's why you're so angry. This is why you were angry a year ago when you came to the USA thing. We had to remove you from that. And honestly, we've just been very tolerant of you being so angry now. Now, you have improved a little over the course of the few days. Instead of being this real dark, you know, thing sitting there with a terrible look on your face, projecting all this rage out, at least now there's some engagement. But you're going to have a good look at this rage and your justification of it if you're ever going to grow.
I'm really struggling to see how it's a sin. I'm desperately trying to see that it's bad, and I can't see
Ella,
that
can
it's
I just
bad
stop you?
What I'm doing.
If you and Sandra also, where's Sandra at the moment? Yeah, this applies to you too. If you can't see your rage as a sin, I don't know how to get through to you, because the reality is you're going to have to at some point see that rage causes huge amounts of damage to your external environment at some point, and to yourself, by the way. Like, and if you can't see that, I would put to you that you don't want to see that. That's what I would put to you. Can we move on? If we come across here, thanks. Just behind you here. And by the way, can I just say to you, I'm not judging you here. I'm just saying where you're at, straight out, blunt, right? Most of you have never had this because you've never even wanted it, right? But I'm saying it's a condition of you staying here today. So if you don't want it right now in this discussion today, then that's fine. Leave right now. I'm okay with that. I'm not going to judge you for leaving or any of those things. I'm not. But if you want to engage myself, Cornelius and Mary, you're going to have to engage us with some sincerity today. Yep. Fire away.
Hi, Jay. My name is Rosa.
Yep.
And it's very difficult for me to speak up right now.
Mm-hmm. Why? Can you see that was just in another addiction that you just met?
I thought I was sincere then.
No, it was just an addiction you met.
Okay.
But why is it an addiction you met? See, when I put up my hand and I engage a person, do I say first, I'm feeling afraid and a bit angry and a bit upset and a bit all... Do I do all of those things with you when I engage with you?
Mm.
Do I even tell you what I'm feeling? No, I don't at all. So why do you do that with me?
Don't know.
Because you want a man to take away some of this fear for you.
Mm.
Right? You have a lot of fear, right?
Yeah.
Yep. And you know that the engagement with divine truth has caused a lot of fear-based things to occur in your life, hasn't it? And you've been living in this fear, and you still have a strong belief that you're very afraid of truth.
Sorry, very afraid of?
Very afraid of truth.
Of truth?
Yeah, aren't you? But you don't tell people the truth of even where you are, do you?
I don't know, because I think I do. But maybe I don't.
No, you're very afraid of truth. But why did you put up your hand?
Because when you said before that people have not engaged, that means they have not been participating. Mm. I didn't feel that way. And I just wanted to let you know that.
I know you didn't feel that way. That's great that you're being honest. But I'm telling you that all of you who haven't put up your hands and actually engaged something in this process, you've had 4 days of opportunity and you didn't do it in 4 days. And that tells me a lot about you. It tells me that you didn't have a very strong desire to graze. You just want to sit there and make us do everything. Sit there and make somebody else do all the work. So I can't agree with you. You're entitled to your own opinion, and it's sincere, I know. I know that's a sincere opinion of you. I just disagree with you completely. I don't agree that what you've done is engaged.
Okay.
Huh? So we have a differing opinion there, and it's up to you what you do with that. If we come across to Julie over the side here and Phoebe over that side, thanks. This is the first honest conversation we're actually having. It's fantastic.
Julie, hi AJ.
How are you doing, Julie?
I'm very scared of truth. Yep. And I use superiority and I use engagement as such with people, you know, to ask questions when I'm chatting to people.
Can I just stop you, Julie?
Yeah.
It's interesting. I agree with some of those statements, but, you know, you are one of the persons who I feel has been sincere this week.
I don't.
Isn't that interesting?
Yeah, I don't.
There's another person who I feel is being sincere and you don't believe you've been sincere.
Yeah, I know.
Can you see a problem with where you're at? Like, you're already incorrectly seeing where you're at.
Yeah, I think I'm pretty low right down.
Yeah, you already believe that you're, like, gone, really, don't you?
I do, actually.
You're not. But this opens you to manipulation by women in particular who believe themselves to be superior to you. Why do you think you've been living with Barb for such a long time? Because she believes she's superior to you.
Because I feel I'm inferior.
Correct.
Yeah, I do.
I know.
Mm. Yeah, so I I know I went into a job that I could just be in a facade and have the support of a uniform to help me feel.
In charge.
In charge.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep. So you used to be an air hostess, if I explain to others.
That's right, yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. So I do the avoidance of everything, so... I don't have to confront how I...
One thing, though, that I feel with you is that you do fairly well accurately assess where you are. This is the funny thing that I find and Mary finds with you, and we enjoy your company because of this, because when you do assess yourself, you are relatively accurate when you engage personal assessment. However, where you're not relatively accurate is when you assess where other people are in comparison to yourself.
That's true.
Right? And so what you finish up doing is listening to people who are in a darker condition than you are, and you start doing what they say. And do you know what that's going to do? Just make you get into a darker condition.
Yeah, degrade me. Yeah.
Yeah. It's very negative for you to not truly honour and see where you are.
Yeah. Thank you for that. That's really helpful for me, because I guess I...
If you just hold out the mic.
Sorry. Yeah, I just... I guess that self-doubt of myself all the time causes me,
to just accept what's coming at you.
I just accept,
Yeah, and you know, you're surrounded by women who believe themselves to be superior to you.
But I sort of think I have that superiority, though.
No, you have a desire to have it, and that's a different...
Okay.
So you see them as the ideal woman. This is part of the problem. You see a woman who you feel is superior to you as the ideal, and you strive to be like her. But from God's perspective, you're actually in a better condition of love, but you're listening and aiming towards. So it's like you're here, you're like over here where you've got some personal truth and you start to see where you are. But you know where you're aimed, where you're headed? You're headed this way.
Wow.
And the reason why you're headed this way is because you believe that these women who are talking to you are in a better place than you are, and that's where you need to aim. And they are in complete la-la land of facade and addiction, and that's where you're headed. It doesn't mean that's where you are right now. It means that's where you're headed if you keep listening to them. Does that make sense?
It does, but AJ, I just have the anger feeling inside of me, and I know that that degrades me. I feel attacked.
Yeah. When?
When there's a superiority and I feel the inferiority.
You are being attacked. The reason why you feel attacked is whenever you're around another person who believes themselves to be superior to you, they are attacking you. That's why you feel attacked, because you are being attacked.
Yeah, but then I feel the rage inside, so I feel I'm so rageful.
I agree. You get angry about it. What is it? Why do you get angry about it?
Because I feel belittled and I feel dumb.
No, you don't feel any of those things.
Don't I?
No, you suppress those things.
I suppress
them. See, if you were really feeling those things, you'd have a big cry. Yeah. You wouldn't get angry, you'd have a big cry. Yeah. You'd let yourself feel some of the hurt self. You follow?
Yes.
That's what would happen. Yeah. But you don't let yourself do that because you believe these women are superior to you in your mind, and that's where you're aiming towards.
Yeah. But I thought that was my superiority coming into play.
No, it's not. It's your inferiority coming into play.
Yeah.
Can you see?
I twist it around.
You do.
Yes.
But you know why? Because you're totally open to these kind of women from a spirit and person, you know, face-to-face interaction. And you listen to whatever they say and believe whatever they say. And a lot of it's a heap of crap. And you just believe it.
Wow.
And you've got to look at why do you want to believe these women who are in a darker condition than yourself?
Yeah.
And the problem with listening to them is you're going to end up in their condition.
Yeah.
And that's very, very sad. That's not heading the right way.
No.
Do you see?
Yeah.
So what we love about you, myself and Mary, is that you are self-reflective. You do see where you're at. But the problem you have is that you listen to people who you
that's
believe
true.
Are better than you.
Yes.
And you're aiming your life in that direction.
Yeah.
And you're going to just, like, there's a lot of sadness in that direction, girl.
Yeah.
Lots of sadness in that. You look at their life. Do they look very happy?
Yeah.
Aren't they just enraged?
Yeah.
You know? So let's get honest about it, see?
Yeah. It's the honesty.
Well, you're honest with yourself about what's going on for yourself to a degree, but you're not honest about them and what's going on and what you feel from them.
Yeah, that's true.
And this is about you not wanting to be honest about what you've felt most of your life from your mother and other women all your life, you know. And this is you aiming for an ideal that's just an ideal in your mind that's got nothing to do with love.
Yeah.
So you need to change where you're aiming, the direction you're going.
Yeah.
Make sense?
Thank you.
Yeah. Phoebe.
I've always been terrified to engage both of you.
I agree. Why?
I'm afraid of truth, I think.
I agree. Why?
Because I...
When you hear truth, what does it make you feel about yourself?
Pretty shit.
Yeah. Okay, so this is about not wanting to feel about my true condition.
Yeah.
Yeah, many of the women in the audience have the same issue. Yep, that's why they're so afraid.
Mm. What I was going to say, though, was that I feel like I've got this demand coming at both of you to engage me, like at the dinner table.
Yeah, you want us to do the work.
Yeah.
Yeah, many of the women in the audience have this same concept that as long as we do all the work, then it makes them feel like, oh, I'm better than what I thought I was, and yeah. You know, all these kind of things makes them feel that they're addicted to having somebody in a position of that they feel is in a position of power. And by the way, we do not have any power over you whatsoever. But it's your belief if you think we do. Someone in authority, I don't have any authority over you. God has authority over you. God's laws have authority over you. That's the only things that have authority over you, right? And by the way, those laws and God has the same authority over me as you. So I'm just a person. You're just a person. So why all the fear?
I don't know. I feel like you can see everything of me, and
I can. And what does it feel like?
I thought I wanted to know, but then every time I see you, I don't. Like, I would rather run the other direction.
Yes. So what's the addiction? It's an addiction to running away from truth.
Yeah.
It's an addiction.
Yeah.
What you feel impelled to run away from truth. Whenever you're in our company, you remember the emotions. Corny's going to remind you of them today in the homework. The emotions of the addiction, the compulsion feeling, you know, the panic, the all of that stuff, which is all part of that. I've got to go in the office. Like, I think I will. This, like, how many of you have said to yourself, this time when I interact with AJ and Mary, this is what I'm going to do. And then you get to interact with this, and what do? Completely the opposite thing in a lot of cases, right? And why does that happen? Because you're in compulsion in that moment. You're compelled by an emotion within your soul, dragging you in another direction. That's an addiction. Right? So there's an addiction inside of many of you to run away from truth. That's why we've found it so hard talking to you this week already. Because many of you are addicted to running away from truth.
Like, I think I want it, you know, when I'm not around you, like, I'll listen to stuff all the time and I'll feel like I'm engaging the
process.
Okay,
can I just say to you, between the two of us, who do you think's the most open person to truth?
You.
Right? Now, if you come into my company and you run away from me, do you really want truth in your day-to-day life?
No.
So what do you want in your day-to-day life?
To get away from it.
You want to run away from truth, right? If you do it when you're with me and you're doing it when you're with God, don't you think you're already doing it? Don't tell yourself the lie that you're better when you're away, because you're not. You're worse. Does that make sense? Like I said, if you can't do it here, then you're going to do it worse out there in the world. Not better. Right? A lot of people think when they engage myself, Mary, Corny, personally, they go, oh, well, that didn't go very good. It's a good thing that my day-to-day life's not like that and I do better. No, you're not doing better. It's just that you're with a person who's got more truth in them, a more openness to truth and no judgment about it and all that. And once you get into those kind of situations, you're just out of control with addictions, trying to pedal backwards, you know, going, ah! It's sort of like you can imagine yourself riding a push bike down a very, very steep hill, trying to go backwards with your legs, going, ah! Just trying to stop, brakes on. And this is where many of you are going, like, and the hill is where you need to go in this case. You need to go into all of the stuff that's really going on in your life, but you're in a panic, brakes on, trying to ride backwards and screaming your lungs out while you're going down the hill. Now, that's not what I would call an openness to truth. That's like a resistance to truth. God's going to get you there sooner or later. Now, I've got friends in the first century still in the hills. God's going to get them there sooner or later. You know, it might take them 10,000 years, 20,000 years. God's going to get there sooner or later. It's far better to embrace the process than it is to try and pedal back, go backwards. And God's okay with your screaming as well. But every time you're trying to go backwards, trying to go against the grain of all of God's laws, trying to go against the grain of truth, nothing's going to turn out well.
So I'm being pretty insincere with seeing myself where I am on the map.
Well, a lot of you, if you're really, really, like, in the moments of clarity, when you're really brutally honest with yourselves, you go, yeah, maybe I'm here, or something like that. But how long does it take you to get to that point? How much time do you spend feeling that place? Most people just, like, within 1 second, they go, oh, maybe I'm there. Oh, forget about that.
Yeah. You know?
Yes, so some of you have moments of sincerity, what I would classify as moments in a day of sincerity, but no desire to change it, no desire to love. Right? For all the reasons that we've already pointed out to you on day one. And you don't want to feel through them. You just don't want to engage the feeling process. And the feeling process is the only way you're going to cure anything here.
Yeah, because I kind of feel like I've touched on the hurt self, you know, but I have, the last few days I've spent pretty much doubting that any of it's real.
Well, I feel that you've done a lot of touching on what I would classify as the tantrum place of the facade, which is also the case with for many of the women here. But really getting into the hurt self, honestly, how long did Mary say she had to deal with the facade before she got into hurt?
Yeah, 5 years.
5 years. And she said now she's starting to feel like she's getting into the hurt, the real hurt that's present. Before then, she felt hurt. If you ask Mary, like, you know, 3 years ago, did she feel hurt? Like, Mary went through a patch where she just felt like, instead of, let's ask her, maybe if I could just have Corny grab the camera and...
Bruce or Kel, would you mind grabbing the mic?
Bruce or Kel, if you'd be willing to handle the mic, the mic's over there. If you just come and join me, babe. Now, you said to the group that you were 5 years in facade. Mm-hmm. During those 5 years, what did you feel a lot of the time?
Miserable.
Yeah, when you say miserable, if you could describe more of the feelings.
Well, I was going through a lot of the feelings of having to face the painful truth of where I was really at. I couldn't deny that when the truth was presented to me. I tried a lot of times, as
so
you know,
when you
to deny
faced
it.
The painful truth, you cried a bit, didn't you?
I cried a bit, yeah, because it was deconstructing my facade. I couldn't hold on to that part of me anymore that thought, no, you're really loving, no, you really care about people, all those things. I couldn't hold on to that belief anymore. So I wasn't touching my hurt self, but I was having a cry about, oh, that sucks, that feels bad.
But also would often get angry.
Oh, yes, many times during that process.
Before
I was
you got to the darkness.
Yes. Well, I fought the truth. You know, even though I said to you guys I had a strong desire for truth, I still fought it a lot of times. It was just that I could go so far in the fight and then I would have to say, no, but truth is still really important to me. So I'm going to have to do some emotional work on getting rid of this facade that I have or the addiction that I have. And sorry, you want to...
I was just thinking, though, that there was also this pattern that developed, wasn't there, where you would start to try to maintain the facade or the addiction, and I'd point something out to you. Initially, you'd get really angry with me, and then I'd draw the line and say, you're not getting angry with me. You're either out the door or you deal with this anger in a more appropriate way. Mm-hmm. So eventually you started to learn that you had to go out every time you're angry and bash something. So Mary eventually went out... Like, in the course of a day, we'd have 5 conversations. She'd be outside bashing them after every conversation.
Yep.
About how angry she felt about it being true. Does that make sense? And every day, for weeks on end.
Yeah.
Like, and then eventually you got to the stage where you knew it was true, and that's when you felt a lot of these tears of what we'd probably call the tantrum tears.
Yeah, and the pain, it felt like the pain of having to let go of something that I thought about myself. I couldn't deny, I had the evidence in front of me that it wasn't true, and so I was going to have to come to grips with the fact that this is where my soul's at right now.
Yeah, so this is all about the pain of the law of compensation.
Yes.
Does that make sense to you? Mm-hmm. So she's starting to feel all the truth about what's going on inside of her soul, and she's starting to feel how bad that feels to feel this way. And during that time, you'd probably say that's the darkest time of your life, wouldn't you?
Definitely. I felt unhappy a lot of you saw me in that time, you know. I still tried a bit of facade, but you could feel how unhappy I really felt. And how much I maybe wanted truth, but it was personally confronting me every day.
And during that time, you'd get a lot of emails of women saying, yeah, you're being manipulated, you're being controlled, all just to try to make Mary feel that actually it was my problem that she was feeling so sad. Right? Why? Because if they had got through to Mary at that point, where do you think she'd be now? Back where she was. So she gets all this attack during that time as well. So you're going through all these feelings that feel real bad, and then on top of that, you're getting attacked.
And not just by strangers, by my family, by my people that I had in my life. A lot of people told me that I was doing something really bad for myself, but I could feel that I wanted truth, you know. And I could also feel that... the person with me was not encouraging me in self-punishment. And so that helped me a lot to realise, oh no, this horrible self-punishment I go to, that's, I'm actually being loved enough to say, don't do that, but the truth still stands, you know. And I also went through in this period something I talked to you guys about in the Challenging Addictions talk, about where you feel the addiction and the false beliefs in that addiction. You know, I had very strong false beliefs about what love was, that love meant taking away fear, that love meant bartering, and all of those things had to be given up. So there was a lot of crying in that, but that wasn't yet touching my hurt self. That was just giving up a lot of falsehood.
Yeah, you could almost say that was the period where you felt you were being hurt, when now when you look at it, you weren't being hurt at all.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And yeah, I had to feel those things as well. But this is where the truth's so important. You can't kid yourself that you're actually feeling the hurt self in that place. And that table that Jesus showed me, that I showed you, that he'd shown me about God's truth and my personal feelings, helped a lot in that period of like, well, does God love in this way? No. So obviously what I'm feeling is just error that I'm going to have to let go of. Mm. Anyway,
good.
Is that enough?
Yeah, yeah. Thanks, mate.
Yep. Thanks, God.
Okay. Now, we could probably have this discussion for a while, right? But what I would like to do is we have a break, but after the break, and what I want to do is raise with this entire group your biggest group addiction that you've been engaging the entire week, males and females, right? Does that sound all right to you? Because if we start facing this biggest group addiction, then we'll get to the bottom of why there has been so much oppression in this group going on, right? Why it's been so difficult in this group to get through to you. And it's a lot to do with what's going on with the biggest group addiction, the one that all of you, pretty much everyone bar just one or two people, have here. The one or two people, by the way, have a whole separate other set of addictions, but bar one or two, this is the biggest group addiction. So I'd like to talk to you about that next. And you have a chance again for the next 50 minutes after that to engage me honestly and truthfully about this addiction. Is that all right? Okay, well, let's have a break. Come back in 10 if we can.